Today's lecture is called Mathematics of Stem Cells. And I will not be talking about controversial embryonic stem cells. Rather, I'll be speaking about adult stem cells that exist in every organ. So everybody has them. They are organ specific. They do not perform any function of the organs. But instead, they're sitting there protected in stem cell niches. They're immortal, and they serve as a reservoir of cells to replenish those cells that perform their functions and that are lost. So for instance, this diagram shows skin. So here at the top are the surface of the skin, and you can see that there are several layers that consist of different types of cells, and the stem cell is sitting here at the bottom. So when you go to the beach, you're exposed to the radiation, the top layer of cells is going to be shed and lost. How do you replace it? Well, some cells beneath it are going to divide, and then these are going to divide, and eventually the stem cell divides. And it provides a blueprint of the cells that are undamaged, and they can go on and divide and perform their functions. So basically, this is how this all works. Stem cells are very useful. At the moment, there is a lot of research going on of how to use them in medicine to treat various conditions. But today I'm going to concentrate on one aspect of adult stem cells, which is their involvement in cancer. So, and this is probably the craziest statement I'm going to make. I'm a mathematician. I'm going to say that cancer is a disease of numbers. And let me show you why. So here's a diagram that shows cells. The stem cells are shown in dark, okay, and this is the top layer. Let's suppose that some cells are lost. That's a normal thing, okay? And they have to be replaced. So what happens is the cells in the previous layer divide, and they move forward, and they kind of redistribute, right? Then this is going to divide and redistribute. And eventually, the stem cell divides and replaces what was lost. And the process goes on, right? Like this. This is normal. Everybody has this. But at some point, you know, a division can happen that involves a mutation. Mutations are rare. 10^-7 per cell per division. But because there are so many divisions, it's possible that a mutation can happen. And the mutated cell starts doing its thing, and you can see that it behaves a little bit differently. It's now this cell's turn to divide, and this, but it divides out of turn. It doesn't care about what's happening. It doesn't cooperate. It wants to divide. And it keeps going, and then it can create another mutation, and it keeps going, and you can see what this is, right? It's cancer. That's why I say cancer is a disease of numbers, and when the numbers are correct, when everything is fine, that's what we call homeostasis. And homeostasis, the maintenance of homeostasis, requires a very complex machinery to be maintained. A complex and robust system of checks and controls to maintain constant cell numbers. And a mutant can refuse to cooperate, it can refuse to respond to the command from other cells and behave selfishly, and that's the beginning of cancer. Okay, so let me show you some examples of stem cells and their lineages and what we can do to understand them. So this is probably the most famous family tree of a stem cell. These are the cells that are in blood. And you can see that these are differentiated cells. These are the cells that perform their functions. That's what we find in the blood. And there are all these different kinds. This is the stem cell up on top. It sits in the bone marrow, and it only divides when needed to replenish the blood cells that are lost. And there's a system of controls and checks and signals that goes on between all these different types that allows the blood cells to function as a whole, maintain constant numbers, maintain homeostasis, and not go out of control. Another example of a stem cell system is neutral stem cells, right? Or stem cells that are involved in the lining of our colon, olfactory stem cells. These are responsible for the sense of smell, and so on. There are many, many of them, and different groups, the biologists, study regulation that happens in stem cells, and it's very complex. So this diagram is about neural stem cells, and you can see that as a stem cell differentiates, becomes more and more kind of defined, and starts performing the function of the neural cells. There are all these things, different chemical compounds that become active, and they regulate what's happening with the cells. So what I'm going to concentrate on is how the body maintains homeostasis and what happens when it goes wrong. Right. So here's a simple, very simple diagram that helps me, a mathematician, to think about these things. So let's suppose that the blue cells are stem cells and the red ones are differentiated cells. And let's suppose that cell dies, right, as they do. It performs its function. It's scheduled to die. It's normal. Here's a hole. And now what's going to happen? Something. There are three things that can happen. Three types of divisions of the stem cell that can potentially replace the lost cell. The first type of division is what they call an asymmetric division. A stem cell divides, and one of the daughter cells is a stem cell, and the other one is a differentiated cell. The second type of division is called proliferation. Both daughter cells are going to be stem cells, so blue. And the last one is a differentiation, when a stem cell divides and both offspring are red, differentiated cells. Question? Is it? Oh, the probability is a key word here. Let me. So it's very important to get the probabilities right, and so it's coming up. So these three different processes work in the following way. So if it's this kind of division, if you have X stem cells, after this division, it's still going to be X stem cells because the number of stem cells doesn't change. If it's this kind of division, X goes to X plus one. There is an extra stem cell that is created here. And here, X goes to X minus 1 because a stem cell is lost, right? So we can assign probabilities to these different events, as was suggested. And if the probability to decrease the number of stem cells is greater than to increase it, then the stem cells will disappear, right? They'll just go away. If it's the other way around, they will expand out of proportion. Not good either. If they're exactly the same, if the probability to increase the number of stem cells is equal to the probability of to decrease the number of stem cells, you may think that that's good, but it's not. Because mathematically, this process is what they call a drunkard's walk or a gambler's ruin. Both are not good. Why are they not good? Because they go like this, up and down, up and down. The number of stem cells will go up and down randomly, and eventually, they will either disappear or grow out of proportion. So we cannot keep the probabilities constant and equal to each other. We have to control them. They have to respond to what's going on in the system. The number of divisions of each kind has to be fine-tuned with what's going on in the system. It's not constant. It's controlled by the environment and by the current state of affairs. So some sort of feedback regulation or control is required to obtain a steady state. And people always assume that such control exists. So these are excerpts from other people's papers. And you can see all these arrows that go from one cell type to the other. Cells control each other, but nobody really knows how this happens. It's just assumed that it happens this way or another way, right? And as a mathematician, of course, I want to study it all of these control networks. And that's what I call the calculus of stem cells. Right? We want to consider all sorts of control that one cell type exerts on another cell type and study their properties, what they're good for, what they're bad for, what are the advantages and disadvantages of each system of controls. If we understand this, maybe we can move a little bit closer to understanding how we function and how we fail to function. So what is control? So this is a stem cell, and in its life, it faces decisions, just like we do. One decision is whether to divide or not, and that has to be controlled by other cells. When it decided to divide, in the simplest case, as I already showed you, it can decide to divide, to differentiate or to proliferate, okay? And there are all these cells that are surrounding my cell of interest, and there are chemicals that diffuse from the other cells that reach the cell in question and they tell it what to do, right? So that's control. And mathematically, we present it like this. We have a cell. It decides to divide and then decides to whether differentiate or not. And there are controls that regulate these decisions. So we can draw arrows that go from cell populations to decisions. And we can draw them in different ways. Or we can assume that there are three types of cells: stem cell, intermediate cell, differentiated cell, and draw controls. And one question, so mathematics can tell you about these systems. For example, what is the equilibrium number of stem cells? Or what are the stability properties? Or how much variance or fluctuations are you going to have in the system? We can talk about minimal controls. Basically, what is the smallest number of controls that allow us to maintain the system and allow it to keep going like this? For example, if we only have two compartments, stem cells and differentiated cells, there are exactly two arrangements of arrows that are compatible with stability. If we have three compartments, stem, intermediate, and differentiated, we have 20 networks of control that are compatible with stability. So which one is there? Which one will nature choose to perform its function in the body? So the first little result that I'm going to tell you about is an algorithm that we designed that allows you to figure out which control system is in place. And this example is about colon. My colleague, David Axelrod at Rutgers, counted the number of stem cells, the number of intermediate cells, and the number of differentiated cells in the people's colons. And from this information, we can figure out which of the 20 possible networks of control is in place, right? So, and we design an algorithm that kind of narrows down the possible control networks. So there are 20. Then we cross out the ones that are non-local, when one type of cell controls something that's far away. That's not possible in the system. So those are gone. Then only local controls. Then we cross out the ones that do not produce the correct means and variances of the number of stem cells, differentiated cells, and so on that were measured. Okay, that narrows it down a bit more. Then we look at the recovery. Some of these systems are oscillatory and some are not, and we want to be oscillatory. And then we look at something else that's what we call intra-crypt correlation, and we are left with only two. So out of 20, we narrow down to two systems of control that can possibly be there. So that's one application of mathematics that can perhaps help understand what's going on. Next, I want to talk about symmetry. Symmetry of stem cell divisions. As I already told you, these two symmetric types of division. A stem cell can divide into two stem cells, or a stem cell can divide into two differentiated cells. And there is this very interesting type of division, which is an asymmetric division, when the stem cell, when the two offspring of a cell have different properties, asymmetric divisions. So the question is, so when the stem cell goes through its decision tree, it has another decision to make. Do I divide asymmetrically or symmetrically, right? Everything has to be controlled. So the question is, what is better under different circumstances, to divide symmetrically or asymmetrically? And thinking simply, if you divide like this, the number of stem cells doesn't change. So this should be more stable somehow. There are fewer possibilities to go wrong. When you divide like this, the number of stem cells either increases by one or decreases by one. So you'd think that that's more unstable. So the interesting part about this project is that this simple intuition doesn't work. And that's one of the favorite parts of my work, is when I can show something that is counterintuitive. Okay, so simple reasoning tells you that this type of division is better, but it's not. So the example comes from our studies of mouse stem cells. It has been established that in the ear and in the tail, about 20% of stem cell divisions are symmetric. And in the foot, twice as many stem cell divisions are symmetric, right? Why? Why is that? So it turns out that when we run computer simulations, one type of stem cell divisions reacts better to noise. So what's the difference between an ear and a foot pad from the point of view of stem cells? The mouse uses its feet to walk, to dig, so there is more damage, there is more disturbances, more fluctuations, more noise that the stem cells there experience. So we are going to look at a noisy system, like a foot, and a more kind of system with less noise that is like an ear. And we assume that here, the cells only divide asymmetrically, and here they divide symmetrically. And we're going to increase the number of the amount of noise. So we increase the amount of noise, and you can see that asymmetrically dividing cells kind of decrease a little bit, but they're still there, and these are okay. Then we increase noise even more, and the asymmetrically dividing system fails, while the symmetrically dividing system is still there. So that tells me that somehow the symmetrically dividing system is more resilient against noise. And so here's what we think happens. Let's suppose that in the ear and the tail, we have 20% of symmetric divisions, and this tells you the amount of fluctuations that the system experiences. Now we increase the amount of damage, like in the foot, okay? And now variation becomes too much. It's not physiologically possible to maintain a system with so much variation. Now we switch to 40% of symmetric divisions. And now we are back at a tolerable level of fluctuation. So that's what we think happens there. So that's what happens in the foot pad. Increase the number of symmetric divisions and resist noise this way. Okay. Another example of mathematics that we think can be useful is our studies of airway epithelium. This is a very interesting system of stem cells and two types of differentiated cells, secretory cells and ciliated cells, that line the tube that we use to breathe. Okay. As usual, the stem cells don't perform a physiological function. Secretory cells excrete fluid that catches the pollution from the air. And ciliated cells have little whiskers also to help us to get rid of pollution in the air. This is a mathematical diagram of all the processes that could happen to the stem cells and differentiated cells in the system. They divide, they differentiate, they de-differentiate, all sorts of different things. 11 different processes that are there. And what we want to know is how they're regulated and what's going on. And you can imagine that there are many different ways in which they can be arranged. For example, we can imagine that all the cells divide symmetrically, okay? Or everybody divides asymmetrically, or there is a mix between the two. So we calculated the amount of variance that happens in the system under each arrangement of divisions. And we thought maybe nature chooses the system that decreases variation. We want something very stable, something that's very good at homeostasis. And we came up with this system. It has a certain arrangement of arrows, okay? And I'm going to skip details, but I say that to our delight, there was an experimental paper that actually measured these things, and they confirmed exactly the arrangement of arrows that we found theoretically. And to us, this was a demonstration of the principle. Perhaps nature chooses a network that is trying to minimize variation, which means that we can find it in a rational way, mathematically, by just calculating variance and making sure that it's the as small as it can get. So basically, the system that is very good at keeping homeostasis will be the one that has evolved. Finally, I'm going to talk about something useful. This is an application of our work to treatment. And I will concentrate on the cancer of the blood called CLL, chronic lymphocytic leukemia. This is the most common type of leukemia. Manifests itself as an accumulation of a certain type of white blood cells. Most patients are diagnosed by chance when they go for a routine blood test. There's no symptoms to start with. And when the contents of the blood are measured, the disease can be found this way. Up until a couple of years ago, the approach to treatment this disease was wait and see. Why is that? Because they used to use chemotherapy to treat this disease. And they would treat it early, or they would wait and treat it later. It made no difference. In survival, it made no difference in symptoms. So wait and see was what was happening. There are different ways to classify this disease, which are different in the United States and in Europe. They look at blood counts and doubling time and so on, and then they decide, okay, now it's time to treat. So this is the combination of treatment that has been used historically. Now, I already showed you this diagram of hematopoietic or blood stem cells. And this is where this disease manifests itself. This is the cell type that grows out of proportion and is responsible for this disease. B lymphocyte. These are a type of immune cells that create antibodies. And basically, they multiply and kill the patient eventually. There are different types of the disease, depending on the mutations that are found in the cells. This one is the most benign and has the best prognosis, and this one is more or less deadly, and traditional drugs simply don't work for this one. Okay, so in 2014, a new drug was invented called ibrutinib. It's a very clever compound that specifically binds to something that is very much involved in CLL. So BTK is an enzyme that is involved in divisions and functioning of cancerous cells. And ibrutinib binds to that and eventually leads to cell death. So it works specifically against cancerous cells. And it was a great breakthrough. But when they did clinical trials, some very strange things were happening in the blood of the patients that were involved. So to explain that, let me first show you a different drug. That's a very famous drug, Gleevec, that was invented about a decade ago against a different type of leukemia, CML. It's the first drug of that type that went specifically after the cancerous cells. And you can see this is the number of cancerous cells as time goes by. And for all these cases, it goes down. Yeah? You start treatment and the number of cancerous cells decreases. Sometimes it comes back, like here. That's not good, right? But when you start treatment, it goes down. And that's what you'd expect of a successful drug. Now look at this new drug, ibrutinib, for CLL. These are actual patients. It goes up. And it's very scary for the people who are involved. It goes up, and then it comes down. So it was a big problem with the drug. It seemed to work eventually, but first it gave this strange behavior, which was called lymphocytosis, right? The great increase in cancer before the decrease. So the reason for this can be explained in the following way. CLL, leukemia, lives not only in blood, it mostly resides in tissues that are depicted here, like thymus or spleen, bone marrow. So it's actually hidden away, and only a small part of the cancer cells make their way into blood. So here, this is tissue. Most of the cells are concentrated there. And there is blood, and in the tissue, the cancerous cells are in a very comfortable environment. They love it. So they divide and they grow. In the blood, they don't divide or don't grow. They just kind of spill out there and then they come back, okay? So when we apply ibrutinib, the cancerous cells that live in tissue spill over to the blood more, okay? So that's why we have this growth. When the patients are checked, they measure their blood contents, they don't go inside their tissue. So the number of cancerous cells in blood increases very much. But so the question was, what does this drug really do? And there are two possible scenarios of how it works, okay? The first scenario is what they call death by neglect. So we have cancer in the tissues, and ibrutinib simply kind of brings the cells over to blood, and cancerous cells are not comfortable in the blood, so they don't divide and they die there, okay? But there's still a great number of dividing cells that feel very comfortable inside the tissue. That's one way of what could be happening. The second scenario is when ibrutinib actually kills the cells at home, and that would be better. That would be a more efficient drug. So nobody knew what was going on. So we applied mathematical theory to data to figure out which of the two scenarios were going on. So we made a mathematical model, applied the drug, and we write down some equations. And so these are 10 patients. The dots are the measurements, the lines are the mathematical model that predicts the same behavior. So we were able to do a couple of things. We were able to measure parameters of individual patients, and each person is different. You can see these are individual people. The dots are true measurements, and they all behave slightly differently. Why? Because people are different. Their cancers are different, their blood is different, everything is different. So each patient has individual parameters. So we were able to measure those parameters. That's one thing. Here are the parameters. And also, we're able to measure the death rate of cells in the tissue and in the blood. And the question is, does ibrutinib really kill cells in the tissue, or does it just kind of redistribute it to the blood? And the result is that the treatment increases death rate in the tissue fivefold, which is pretty good. It increases death rate in blood threefold. And it actually doesn't do very much to the redistribution. So the migration rate increases a little bit, so that's responsible for a temporary increase in the number of cells in the blood. But really, the biggest job that the drug is doing is killing the cells in the tissue. So that was good. And that this helped in the approval, FDA approval of the drug when it finally happened in 2015. This theory went into that because it allowed us to understand what the drug is doing. And the last thing I want to talk about is this fact about measuring parameters for individual patients. So everybody is talking about personalized medicine. We want to treat each patient according to their own, you know, standards, based on their own personal situation, their physiology, and their type of disease. So what we are doing here is a step toward that scenario. In this paper, we looked at ibrutinib again, but we looked long-term, right? At the beginning, we know what happens. The number of cells in the blood goes up, then goes down, and it seems to work. But then, after a little while, some patients' treatment fails. So this is the number of studies that we list here. This is the duration of these studies. Many people perform these studies. And sometimes one or two patients or four or eight fail. In the end, they have a disease that kind of comes back. So we wanted to look at those cases, the patients for which the treatment doesn't work. This is what they call resistance. resistance to drug. It has been studied biologically. The reason for resistance is a mutation. Remember, ibrutinib binds to BTK, that thing that allows the cell to function, and kills the cell. Now, this little star is a mutation in BTK that modifies it a little bit in such a way that the drug cannot bind to it anymore, so it becomes ineffective. The second little star is a different type of mutation. It has nothing to do with BTK. It's a mutation somewhere else. But it works in the following way. Ibrutinib binds to BTK, but the cell somehow manages to survive without BTK. So both of these mutations are bad because they prevent the drug from working in these two very different ways, you see. So we wanted to see what happens to the patients who experience this. And there are three questions. Are resistant mutants already in the blood of the patients when they come to see a doctor? Or are they generated during treatment? Right? Is there hope that we can somehow modify treatment and get rid of those mutations? That's the first question. Can we predict the resistance-induced relapse for individual patients? A patient comes to the doctor, they measure some parameters, and we can tell whether the treatment is going to be helpful or not. And finally, if it's predicted that the treatment is ineffective, what can we do? So these are the questions. So the first question, so we designed a model, right? I'm going to go over it quickly. It's a probabilistic model. Everything is random, right? A cell can decide to divide, it dies. It mutates maybe with a small chance and so on, that's a resistant mutation. So if it divides more than it dies, then the colony grows, that's cancer. Now we apply ibrutinib and the probability of death increases. Hopefully the disease shrinks unless there is a mutation. If there's a mutation, it doesn't happen. So there are these mutant colonies that appear all the time by random chance. 10 to the minus 7 per cell division per cell. These mutations appear, they go away, it's random. If one of them is still there when we start treatment, then treatment fails, right? So we want to know whether these mutations come after or before treatment. And so here we can measure parameters. So this procedure describes how individual parameters can be measured in patients in a very painless way. So what we want to know is we want to know the division rate of the cancer, the death rate of the cancer. All it takes is to drink some water. So this is what they call heavy water. It's harmless. Patients can drink it. And then every time a cell divides, the contents of heavy water is diluted in the cells. And you can measure the rate at which individual cells divide in individual patients. So that gives us an individual characteristic of the disease of a given person. So we did that with the patients that we had. And so the first question, do these patients have resistant mutants in their cancer or not? And it turns out that with certainty, we can say that anybody who comes to the doctor with CLL will have resistant mutations in their cancer. There is nothing you can do about it. Treatment does not affect the probability of resistance. It's there, and there's nothing we can do. The question is, how much of it is there, and what can we do to kind of prevent it from happening? So I have to repeat that each person is very different. We're all individuals, right? And the individual parameters vary very much. So these are trajectories of disease taken from individual patients. And you can see that some of these lines go up very quickly, and some of them go up very slowly. This is the resistant disease. This is the disease that is there. The seeds of it are already in the blood. But how quickly is it going to come up? Okay? And for some people, it comes up within 6 months of treatment. And for some of them, for the more lucky ones, it takes more than 30 years. So this is a distribution of times it takes. And so no resistance after 30 years, only 5%. And 6% of the patients will acquire resistance in 2 years. So each person, if their parameters are measured, can come to a doctor and he will be given a prognosis. Okay, for you, it'll probably take 5 years until it comes back. Or you're okay, your disease will be contained for at least 10 years. So the last question is, what are we gonna do if the prognosis is bad, right? So if we have a long time with a non-resistant disease, then we probably should do nothing. It's probably okay. But if it's very short, what are the possible strategies to prevent the disease from killing you? So there are three possible strategies that one could consider. Early treatment. So if we treat very, very early, can it change our odds? Okay. Debulking. This is combining this new drug with old-fashioned chemotherapy that just kind of kills all the cells. So we reduce the cancer very much and then start treatment. Can that help? And finally, combining two different drugs with each other, right? So we put all these three in the computer. And the first question is, can any of these strategies create a miracle and just kind of get rid of resistance? And the answer is no. None of this can get rid of the resistance completely. There is always a probability that there is a resistant mutant. There is always a chance that it comes up. So the question shifts now. We cannot get rid of it, but maybe we can delay it. And that's all we can hope for. If we can delay it enough, that's good enough. So the most promising strategy, it seems, is debulking. We take a chemotherapeutic agent or maybe some immunotherapy, start with that, reduce the cancer by, say, 100-fold, which is possible, and then start treatment with ibrutinib. And it turns out that there is a significant improvement in the prediction when we do that. So this is standard ibrutinib therapy. And this is a therapy with prior debulking. You can see that this peak is much larger here. These are the patients for whom resistance takes more than 30 years to come. So those are the lucky ones. So this is better. And maybe it's hard to read here, but this whole thing is shifted to the right, which means that it takes longer for resistance to show its ugly head. So mathematics here helps us to choose the right strategy. It gives us a prediction, and the prediction can be made personalized. So to conclude, CLL is a disease where all necessary kinetic parameters can be measured individually in patients. We can plug them in the computer and predict what's going to happen. And we can also work out the best strategy to pursue with each individual patient. I would like to thank my group, my students and postdocs who helped me with this work, and my collaborators from UCI and other universities. And partial support of this work comes from NSF and NIH. And these are a couple of books that were published on mathematical modeling of cancer. Thank you very much.